and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Che.
And I'm Ben Peltier. The views of English composers Benjamin Britten and Edward Elgar on the turmoil and struggles of life are the theme of an upcoming program of the Hong Kong Philharmonic Orchestra. Later in the show, I'll be talking to cellist Jan Vogler, who will be playing Elgar's last major work for orchestra, the Cello Concerto.
But first, we're heading down to the Hong Kong Palace Museum to see an exhibition featuring some of the finest artworks collected over centuries by the princes of one of Europe's smaller states, the Principality of Liechtenstein, that lies between Switzerland and Austria.
Odysseys of Art, masterpieces collected by the Princes of Liechtenstein, showcases over 120 paintings, prints, tapestries, sculptures, and decorative art objects selected from over 30,000 works in the princely collections. The House of Liechtenstein is one of Europe's oldest noble lineages. The princes have been collecting art for more than 400 years, mostly to display in their palaces and castles.
In the early 17th century, one of the princes, Prince Carlos I, was serving to the Habsburg Empire in Prague and was responsible to install workshops of artists and to bring artists to Prague and to take care for the royal collection in Prague. He founded the Pietra Dura workshop, which he could use after the death of the emperor only for himself. And so this tradition of collecting started, and it's going through all the family members up to the now reigning prince.
Divided into 8 thematic sections, the exhibition emphasizes the acquisitions of 5 princes whose taste has shaped the collection from the 17th century to the present day. Among the highlights are a series of works by 17th century artist Peter Paul Rubens, the most influential artist of the Flemish Baroque tradition. Three pieces of work on display feature the same mythological subject. Prince Johann Adam Andreas I bought the oil painting Mars and Rhea Silvia around 1700. In 1977, Prince Franz Joseph II acquired a modello, a preparatory study also in oils, for the painting. Even more recently, the current reigning prince purchased this tapestry version based on the paintings.
Yes, it's a very unique story, and it tells us how long-lasting collecting can be. When we look exactly to that painting of Mars and Rhea Silvia, and he has his sword on the right side, so he has to take with the left hand, and the gods at the time could not be a left-hander. And so what's wrong? It's only the cartoon for a tapestry to execute it, and for sure the tapestry always is reversed then.
Rubens is known as the Prince of Painters and the Painter of the Princes due to the frequent commissions he accepted from royal clients. They included altarpieces, portraits, landscapes, and paintings of mythological and allegorical subjects. On a more intimate and personal scale, though, is this portrait of his daughter, Clara Serena Rubens.
It's a very small picture, but of incredible value. It shows his incredible skills. On the one side, he focuses really detailed on the mouth, the nose, the eyes, and the hair in the center of the paintings. The rest, he does not take care a lot, so you really focus in the face of this painting.
Fascinated by the works of Rubens, Johann Adam Andreas I amassed about 50 works by the master. This exhibition includes 36 major works by either Rubens or his best-known and most accomplished student, Antony van Dyck.
We have here the first painting, the Saint Jerome, executed only by van Dyck. and we have portraits. It says two portraits have been painted both in the atelier of Peter Paul Rubens. It's the same technique, obviously, what you see in the first go. And when you look deeper, you learn pretty soon that there are lots of differences. For instance, Rubens always used a yellow background for his paintings. So the flash is getting very intensive. Van Dyck, this young guy, uses a grayish background, so his faces are quite pale.
The exhibition is the first major special exhibition at the Hong Kong Palace Museum since its opening exhibitions. Daisy Wang, the museum's deputy director, says the exhibition itself is part of a history of dialogue and exchange between cultures.
There are many interesting examples. In the past is one of the parks of the princely family, and sort of in the middle of nowhere, you see a Chinese-style pavilion in the 19th century. Also, the princes, they were extremely interested in Chinese and Asian porcelains. And that really showed also the power of China and Asia as well as an exporting country. There are so many similarities between what was happening at Liechtenstein and what was happening in the Forbidden City. You have powerful rulers who are passionate about art, who think art as a demonstration of their prestige and their knowledge. And also, you also have very open-minded rulers who are interested not just in art around them, but art beyond their own sort of culture.
How can music from jazz greats such as John Coltrane, Miles Davis, Bill Evans, Charles Mingus, and Nina Simone be transposed into visual art? That's the idea behind You Will Be Remembered, U.S. artist Adia Millett's second solo exhibition in Asia, which is currently on show at Galerie du Monde.
Millett listened to a selection of jazz music over days and weeks and read commentaries and background on the music to create a series of abstract paintings made up of patterns, shapes, and forms reminiscent of those you might find in quilt-making designs or even stained glass.
I was really interested in craft, dollhouse building, embroidery, quilting, those materials that you didn't traditionally see in contemporary galleries and museums. So when I initially started the project, I wrote a list of jazz musicians, predominantly from the 50s and 60s, but also later, almost all African-American jazz musicians. And then I started to look and listen to find songs that really moved me, that I felt somehow were connected to the racial politics of the United States and the struggle that we've gone through, but also the joy, you know, that comes through in through our culture. One of the pieces that is kind of the starting point for this is a piece titled Love Supreme, which is based on a John Coltrane song called Love Supreme. And that song just moved me so much and had so many layers and has been the inspiration for many other musicians. So there are a couple pieces in this show that kind of reference fire. So the black and blue piece, at the bottom of the piece, there's red kind of spray paint that's coming up, so it almost suggests the fire. It's so much about the history of oppression in the United States for black people. Fire in the Mountain, that one for me was more connected to my own personal history with fire, having lost a family home when I was, I think, 17. It created this really deep connection to fire, how it can take things away, but how it gives us life. I think just be open and don't be afraid of color. You know, there's so much beauty and color in the world, and it gives us an opportunity to see new perspectives.
Welcome back. This Friday and Saturday, the Hong Kong Philharmonic Orchestra is presenting a program of music composed against the backdrop of World War II by Benjamin Britten, Edward Elgar, and Dmitri Shostakovich. One is the orchestral interlude 4C Interludes from Britten's first successful opera, Peter Grimes. There's also Edward Elgar's most confessional and final major work for orchestra, the Cello Concerto. And to complete the concert, Shostakovich's Ninth Symphony. Cellist Jan Vogler is here with us right now to tell us more.
Jan Vogler, welcome to the Works studio.
Very nice to be here. Thank you for having me.
It's indeed lovely to have you here. You're in Hong Kong to perform one of the most magnificent pieces in all of the repertoire. Now, the cello has a number of masterpieces in its repertoire, but among these great pieces, the Elgar is certainly considered to be one of the very best. What is it that you find so attractive about this piece?
It's a very romantic piece. And I think it was the last chance to compose something that was missing in the repertoire. Yeah. A piece that is completely told by this one narrator, the cellist, who starts to talk to the orchestra and slowly kind of involve the orchestra in this intense dialogue. And in the last movement, it's really equal then between orchestra and cello. But in the first three movements, the cellist is really trying to, with this melancholic but yet very strong voice, to involve the orchestra in this dialogue. So it's a very, very special piece that is maybe after the Dvorak Cello Concerto, which is obviously almost as famous, and very different contribution to the great repertoire for cello and orchestra. And somehow it wasn't a success when it was premiered, but it became a huge success in the second half of the 20th century and until now.
You've referenced the melancholic character that pervades much of the piece. It's rather sad at moments, isn't it?
It is sad, but it's a piece of a survivor. It's somehow, sometimes, the most incredible thing about the piece is that it arrives at the end with hope. And I think that's actually the maybe most attractive field for cellists, between, you know, happiness and melancholy in the transition. And I think it's very attractive for many people because we all have moments when we doubt things or when we are a bit blue. At the same time, we are optimists. We want to survive. We want to have hope. And I think that's why maybe the concerto captures so much of the human nature.
I'd also like to address this question to you about repertoire for your instrument and where you've chosen to go as an artist, a kind of walking the line between maybe the standard classics and all this great repertoire of yesteryear, and then new music and exploring quite a number of new pieces and working with composers. So you seem to have walked a bit of a line yourself in your career.
I grew up in a musical family, and when I was a child, everybody came home with an instrument in their hand, or every guest in the house. So I grew up thinking that everybody in the world plays a musical instrument. But that's not the case. So we have to find our audience. And I think classical music is something so wonderful and so magical. But there is a way that we can build bridges. Of course, new works is one way to further the repertoire. So I have usually one premiere a year. Recently, I premiered a concerto that was written by three composers. It was called the Three Continent Concerto, with the first movement being composed by American Nico Muhly. He's a star in America, a young composer. Then the second movement by German Sven Helbig, who is influenced by pop music. And the third movement by Chinese composer Zhou Long, which is a piece that's very much based on traditional thousands of year old Chinese music and poetry. So I think this kind of thing where we can build bridges between the whole world with the piece and can show that we're all human and have different views, but very much the same emotions. But also there are other ways to collaborate. And for me, the repertoire can be very wide, from tango to Elgar concerto. And even on my latest CD, I told the story of the pop song, starting from the very early Baroque times, playing opera arias on the cello through Mozart, through Verdi, Bellini, Wagner, Gershwin, to Michael Jackson and Beatles, to show that actually the modern pop song is based on what opera was in, you know, the 18th and 19th century. And the arias were whistled on the street as much as today some of the most famous, you know, Billie Eilish songs.
The cello is such a marvelous instrument as a solo vehicle for expressing yourself, and composers have gone to that from early days. And so I'd like to know, what would you like to do for us?
I would like to play some Bach. I mean, there are the cello suites by Bach, which are really a monumental work. I often play all six in one evening, which is a bit of a longer concert, but I've done it many times. And I recorded about 10 years ago my version of all the six suites. And I like to play two of the most beautiful movements, like Et Sarabande from the third suite in C major, and the first prelude he ever composed of the first suite, which may be the most well-known piece for cello solo in the whole world.
I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.